What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN Game Scoop. I'm your host, Daemon Hatfield. Joining me this week are Sam Claiborn.
Bing.
Justin Davis.
Scoop.
And very special guest, Ryan McCaffrey, host of IGN's Xbox podcast, Podcast Unlocked, joins us
twice
today.
In 1 week, Daemon. I get to see you twice in 1 week. This is a good thing.
We do our show Next Gen Console Watch every week. We just recorded that yesterday. And I want to have Ryan on the show today, not only because he's always a great guest, has been in the business a very long time, longer than even myself, I believe. But we're also, since we've ticked over to a new month, that means it's time to flip through an old video game magazine. And this week we've got the holiday 2006 issue of Official Xbox Magazine, an issue that Ryan worked on
I wonder what reviews I wrote in that one, because if it was the holiday issue, that means it was all the big fall games.
Is that 360's launch year?
No, that was a year
into 06, right, Daemon?
06, yeah.
So, but that's Gears of War 1, for sure.
Gears of War, yep. The big cover story is the world first reveal of Gears of War 1.
So, cool.
That'll be fun to flip through. But first, some general housekeeping. Next week is the Game Awards. They're happening Thursday, December 8th, 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. And along with the awards, there's always a bunch of big announcements, new trailers, new games revealed. And you're going to be able to watch all of that on IGN, along with our exclusive pre- and post-show coverage. So please be excited for that. Oh, we're looking at it right now. Fast on the B-roll, Tayo. Impressive. That's next week, Thursday the 8th. Game Awards, watch it on IGN. So let's begin this week, before we hop into our magazine, let's begin with a listener mail. So let's go ahead and check in with the listeners.
Hey, listeners.
Listeners, you remember you can always reach us at the email address, gamescoop@IGN, just like Big Tony Style. Big Tony Style says, we're just 1 month away from wrapping up 2022, but I feel like this has been one of the most bizarre gaming years of my life. The highs were high with the likes of Elden Ring and God of War, but I feel like the year was marred with delays, long stretches of no significant releases. You were not wrong, Big Tony Style. That said, there was still more than enough to play, so much that I haven't been able to play many games I want to, like Mario plus Rabbids, Tactics Ogre Reborn, and Bayonetta 3, to name a few. I'm curious, as the year comes to a close, what games will you try to finish up in the coming weeks, and what are some notable games you likely won't get around to? So is everyone else still working their way through God of War Ragnarok?
Yes.
Yep.
Taking my sweet time, trying not to rush.
I have a quest-breaking bug I encountered, and I just have to maybe wait for a patch to finish that quest. It's not a main quest, it's a side quest. But it's about getting these dogs in a cage, and the dogs just think there's an invisible wall there. And I've consulted everybody who's beat that so far, and they're like, you're doing it right, but they just won't go in that cage.
It's the worst.
Can you just move on and leave that side quest behind?
It's a side quest, but I'm 100%ing at least the favors in regions, so it's driving me a little bit crazy, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
This is in Vanaheim, which is a cool area.
Justin?
I finished it.
Oh, there you go. There you go. What are your sort of like final summary? No spoiler thoughts.
It's hard to talk about it in not spoiler terms, because my enduring impression of it is kind of story related and characterization, and this is not a spoiler, but just speaking very generally, like the story kind of goes exactly where you expect it's going to go, but how it gets there is very interesting, and then it also, I don't know, it also leaves you on your toes and ends in a way. It's hard to talk about this vaguely, but yeah. I found that, and it's very, very satisfying and very good. And it's not like, oh, what a twist, I didn't see that coming. And yet you're not going to see it coming. Like, really interesting stuff happens. I was very satisfied and thought it ended on just an excellent note.
Yeah, I was also satisfied. Justin, again, we're avoiding spoilers, but would you agree? I don't really know where the series goes from there.
Yeah, it's really interesting, right? Like, it's very, the storytelling for like big blockbuster video game is, you know, The Last of Us is really kind of a risk-taking game, and so is God of War in a lot of ways.
So Ryan, you're still working your way through God of War. Anything else you're trying to like wrap up before the end of the year?
I am really eager to dive into High on Life, which is an Xbox exclusive that we're getting in like less than 2 weeks, I think, from today as we record this on December 1st. So, but I know I got to get through God of War first before I can get to that. And then there's, I got to say, I shot a video about The Witcher 3 Next Gen the other day.
Yeah.
And that's a game that I purposely didn't spend more than just a couple hours with it back in 2015, because I was honestly just, I knew I'd never finish it, being a 150 hour plus game. But I don't know, man, I really love the Netflix show, and I kind of want to play more of it now that it's going to kind of come back to us as a fresh, you know, with a fresh coat of next gen polish on it. But again, I have no designs on finishing that game, but I do want to spend some more time with it. So yeah, it's kind of, we waited all year for games, particularly if you're an Xbox guy. And now it's just pouring video games right at the end of the year.
I'm still trying to finish up Return to Monkey Island. The game, it's longer than I expected. It's actually pretty.
Do finish it, because I want to talk to you about how the ending goes. And number two, it's just the way it ends is it's. I don't know. I don't want to, like Justin, I want to be wary of spoilers, but it's a beautiful conclusion, and I hope you'll see it through, Damon.
I'm wrapping up the Golden Keys. I think I've gotten all those. So
you got some ways to go.
Oh my gosh, it already feels so long. there's that, and then I wanted to play Vampire Survivors, which is something Justin has been.
Oh, you're gonna love it. Yeah. You're gonna love it. Yeah, it's on Game Pass. Check it out.
Yeah. So I need to do Vampire Survivors. Callisto Protocol is out tomorrow. I'll definitely play that. And then the only other thing that I want to try to wrap up is I haven't played Neon White yet, and I've heard lots of great things about that.
It's coming to other consoles.
Yes, PlayStation, I believe.
So yeah, PlayStation. I don't know the time frame on that.
We just gave a 10 to Pentiment. I feel like we all need to try that too.
I've put in an hour or two, and it's outstanding. I just don't know how I'm going to find time to play it. And it's like, if you need something completely different from any other video game, Pentiment is a good choice for that.
On Game Pass too, so accessible. It's definitely one I want to try. I'm also I just loaded up a bunch of games that are the ones I'm going to try. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do A Little to the Left, which is a moving style game. It's like Unpacking. I think it was developed independently of Knowing About Unpacking, with a cat in it that knocks your stuff around. And then I have Pokemon. I played maybe like 2 hours of the new Pokemon, and I also have Arceus, which I haven't played. And so I'm going to try both Pokemon games. I'm very heartened by the version I'm playing Violet, that it's like the open world cool Pokemon game. Like, it's like what we've wanted for many, many years. But yeah, it's really buggy, and it's ugly. So it's like, even if they fix all the bugs, it's like, what's even challenging this game? I don't really get it. Like, It looks like they took like half of the polygons out of Breath of the Wild, which I don't really understand. If you're watching videos, it's not even like a style choice, really. I don't get it. But the sheer fact that you can walk around a huge open area and just like walk up to Pokemon that you want to catch because you see them in the wild is super cool. It's just really neat. And I think that's just like, it could have a lot of legs if it gets tweaked, and then maybe we'll get a remake or a reboot of it in 20 years.
Yeah, my daughter's got Scarlet on her Christmas list because her friend, one of her best friends, already has Violet. And, it got me thinking when I read the review on IGN with all the technical issues. 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds probably don't even care that it looks like crap and runs like crap. It's more, that's something that adult Pokemon fans are going to key on. And justifiably so, by the way. We should expect better from the Pokemon company and from the developers of the game. But it's one of those things where I'll bet kids probably don't even notice or care.
Yeah, it does have, like, it wouldn't be on shelves if it wasn't playable. Like, it's playable to the point where, like, I totally agree with you. Like, kids will still like this. I think it's a really good introduction to the Pokemon world. And, like, I'd recommend it for younger players. And, like, I don't know. Like, it's just a really cool way to play an open world game that's also an RPG. Like, I'm just happy that like a generation of kids are being introduced to really cool RPGs and Pokemon this way. It's just neat. It feels really cool. It feels like this is what we should have been getting on GameCube, right? Like, that would have been this would have been a really cool match for that.
Well, speaking of Pokemon, let's skip ahead to one of our other listener emails. This is Daryl in DC, who says, I saw the Pokemon floats in the Thanksgiving Day parade. That somehow got me thinking about the fact that typically those games are released in pairs, Red and Blue, Gold and Silver, etc. It made me wonder, is that a successful business play? My assumption is that the business idea here is releasing two versions of the same game with slightly different collectibles in a game where the collectibles are a main part of the gameplay loop would lead to a good portion of the player base buying both games. Is there any data showing it works? That people buy both instead of just one. They've been doing it for decades now, so it would lead me to believe that...
There's your data.
Exactly. It would lead me to believe that that means it's successful. I guess another explanation here is the effort and cost to switch out a few dozen of the Pokemon and the other cosmetic changes is low, so the extra games sold makes up for it. Just wondering if you have any insight in the business of them releasing in pairs and why other franchises have not tried it. Sam?
Well, it's funny to think about other franchises trying it because people might get angry with other franchises trying it. But with Pokemon, it's been baked in from the start. So it's just like what's expected. But I was chatting with Daemon about this a little bit. There's some obvious reasons why there's two versions, but one of them is trading. And Pokemon is, you know, predicated on collecting as many Pokemon as you can, collect them all. And when they lock them behind other games, the intention there is kind of cool. It's not to make you buy two copies and set your Game Boys next to each other and trade with yourself. It's so that your friend has a different version and you have a reason to trade and play with your friend a lot, which I think is like really, really clever and neat. But like it's been that way for a long time. I'm sure it drives people that need to track commerce numbers crazy, like Justin Davis and NPD.
I mean, I don't know. It's not that hard to combine them in our spreadsheets. But like, I think that the trading, I think it's a little bit hokum. Like, I really love Nintendo, and I'm not a big Pokemon guy, but I've admired them from afar for decades. I think that those games get a pass for something that's pretty unfriendly to consumers, that it has these two separate versions and you can't collect them all unless you know somebody that bought the other version or you yourself bought the separate version. Like, there's absolutely no reason that if a game has 150 new Pokemon in it that you know, whatever, like every game has 130 of them and then the other 20, you're going to get 10 of them at random. And then the other 10, like you can still facilitate that trading without having a separate SKU and a separate scout color and a separate version of the game you have to buy. I think it's a little bit gross. And since it's just been that way for like almost 30 years that people just sort of like, it's just one of those things that like we made our peace with, or like, it doesn't even, it's just assumed now that like, of course it's going to be that way. Like the thought experiment that I tried to go through is if it hadn't always been this way, and they tried to do it now, people would lose their minds, right? They'd be like, this is horrible. Like, why are you doing this to us? And so, I don't know. I don't think it's good. I also don't think it's that big a deal because, you know, who cares? Just trade with your friends. But like, I wish they get a pass just because of historical precedent, I think.
Go ahead, Brian.
The last point of that listener email is really what I think the key is how has no one else tried this? Has nobody else seen the success, the rampant success of Pokemon, whether, you know, for whatever the reason, whether we just all accept it as like systemic failure that's just become normalized or what, but somebody, how is no publisher, like Activision's the greediest publisher on the planet. How have they not tried to find a way to do this? Like with Call of Duty, right? Like, oh, you can only get these skins or these maps. You know, I'm shocked that no other publisher has really made a legitimate effort to duplicate that dual SKU success.
Yeah. So a Mega Man Battle Network had two different versions. There's definitely been some others, but I didn't get a chance to like, you know, review, enter my mind palace or like look online to do some research. For some reason, I think that maybe this is super random, that I think Mega Man Battle Network did it, but like certainly not it's not widespread elsewhere, right? But like I think some other games gave it a shot and then kind of walked it back in the future.
So the story is that Pokemon creator Satoru Tajiri was inspired by Dragon Quest II on the Famicom. Mm-hmm. So there's an item in the game called the Mad Cap, which is it's you have a very low chance of finding this cap, and what does it do? It reduces the cost of casting spells. He really wanted to have one, and his friend found two of them. And his friend is now an artist on Pokemon games. And he, so like back then he wished there was a day he could like trade his friend one of his items for this, one of his mad caps. But that was like back on the Famicom days in the 80s. So there'd be no way to do that. So when he grew up and made Pokemon, that was like the like feature he like focused on.
Another interesting point about just trading and collecting in Pokemon in general is that when you expend the effort to, especially back when in the earlier cartridge days, to trade with your friend or go, you know, out of your way to acquire a Pokemon, it made it that much more valuable that you had your full Pokedex. And I think it became a really clever way to get people to not trade in their games because they were personally attached to their Pokemon in a number of ways and have their collection. And, you know, there was, of course, also battling. And so, like, this is, like, the ultimate, like, don't sell this back to GameStop game. And, like, that absolutely was the case. It was so much more unlikely to find a used Pokemon game in, you know, 1999 than it was any other game, which I think was super clever to sell more copies. So, you know, it wasn't just, you know, not only did they sell multiple versions of this game, but they probably sold more just because they sold new copies all the time. And now that you can trade digitally and everything, it's just like, it's taken off a lot of the pressure. You know, I like the idea of trading in person. I like the idea of encouraging that. Not necessarily, you know, as a forcing people to do it, but like, that's the magic of Pokemon Go also. It like made you go outside and go collect Pokemon. Pokemon makes you, you know, kind of go connect with people and trade with people. Like, I think that that's something that, that games don't have to do, but when they do it, it just makes it that much more connected to our society and to reality and to just kind of like integrated into our world in like a cool way. And like, there's room for that. I don't think that there should be a type of game where, you know, every game has to follow the same pattern. Like, I think it's really amazing that Pokemon breaks out of that meme.
It was the go touch grass game before that became a meme, right?
Exactly.
Justin, maybe you have insight into this, but my assumption would be that whatever generation of Pokemon it is, whatever name is first, that one sells better, if that makes sense. Red and Blue, Red sold better.
Well,
Violet, Scarlet, Violet will sell better.
That's true until this generation, and that's something that we've been talking about internally here.
We know that
just because of basically search volume that we have that and some other things that like that it seems like Violet is the more popular game.
Interesting.
And it's never Violet is first. It's Violet and Scarlet, right?
The only one I can remember off the top of my head is that, yeah, Sword outsold Shield by a lot.
Usually the first does.
Something that fascinates me, circling back to what you were just talking about, Sam, is, you know, people don't want to trade in their games. They have these Pokemon. They can trace back their origin to, I worked on a feature, you know, but like Callie did all the work. But like Callie Flaggy and I kind of tag teamed a feature many, many years ago. So you can have Pokemon from the Game Boy Advance, like Pokemon Ruby or whatever from the GBA. And that Pokemon can be traded all the way through various link cables and Pokemon banks and other things into like modern day Pokemon. And it's the same one that you've leveled up and it has its same stats. And like that could have been with you, I don't know how many years now, but over 15 years. And that's unprecedented, right? And like we made a chart on IGN that was like, so to get the GBA Pokemon into the DS, you had to put the DS cart in and the GBA card at the same time. And then you could transfer that Pokemon into the DS version. And then the DS version had this thing called Pokemon Transporter and then later Pokemon Bank that could get them into the 3DS game. And there's always been a method to like carry forward your Pokedex into perpetuity. And like, even though I'm not a fan of these games, like I'm deeply fascinated by that. And like, I find that really cool and interesting and the continuity there. And then it really puts Game Freak in a bind because then they have to, you know, when their games move to 3D, they have to 3D model all of them, right? Like there's 1,500 of them now. So like, how do they, like the debt that they take on with each new generation of Pokemon only gets like bigger and bigger.
Well, Nintendo issued a soft apology for the performance issues on Scarlet
and a software update. Which we're evaluating today. I'm really curious about what it patched up so far.
Yeah.
Damon, I wanted to circle back to Big Tony Styles' question quick.
Yep. Oh, yeah. Thanks thanks to Miyamoto-san for keeping in touch with us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Happy holidays, Miyamoto-san.
We appreciate it. I am probably not going to be playing anything else over the holidays because the only game I play now is Factorio. I looked at my Steam stats. I don't know how this is possible. I have played 75 hours of that game over the last 2 weeks.
Oh, my gosh.
And that's not like that's very out of character for me. Like, I normally like video games are in balance with like TV shows and other stuff I want to do. Like, I think it's been my way of dealing with like Black Friday stress is just lording over these. Factorio is one of those like conveyor belt games where like, you know, you make iron and then you conveyor belt the iron over there to make another thing and then make another thing and like build this big factory. And I just, I played that game, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago, like a long, long time ago. And it's got its claws in me so deep. I'm so hooked. And I just, I can't, I'm probably going to play as soon as this podcast is over. I know that's kind of random, but like, I don't know. Like, I have finally have my own office with a PC, and like, I can close the door, and like, you know, it makes it. It's a heck of a game. Buy it at your own peril.
Is it only on PC?
Yeah. Well, no. It just came out on Switch.
Oh wow! Interesting.
I'm gonna go back to Big Tony Styles' question too, and say that I think the Riddle subplot in God of War is really good.
The Riddle subplot.
Yeah, a riddle is told at one point.
One of the dwarves. I remember.
Then what's his name? Mimir starts like asking riddles of Kratos repeatedly, and it's a little bit of an arc for that. Interstitial dialogue section. It's great.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the holiday 2006 episode of Official Xbox Magazine with Gears of War on the cover, world's first review, and then it says PS3 Crushing Brilliance.
We weren't wrong at the time.
I'm a little surprised. This is an Xbox Magazine. Why is it even mentioning PS3?
Well, you know.
A little antagonistic, but
because the PS3 mentality, you pick on the big guy sometimes.
Well, the 360 would not be the underdog for very much longer.
That's true.
It's funny because now Ryan is often a moderating voice when we're talking about the console wars. It's great. I'm always like, Ryan, let's use this headline. He's like, no, that'll just inflame me.
I'm looking at this, and I'm looking at the 25 reviews at the bottom, mm-hmm. and I'm thinking, did I review Rainbow Six Vegas? I guess we're going to find out. It's been a while.
Did you use a pseudonym?
I definitely didn't review Gears of War. I reviewed Gears 2 and 3, but not the first one.
Okay.
They also have a holiday gift guide and then a feature on whether or not 2007 will be the best gaming year ever.
Oh, we were right about that one, too. Yep.
It was
we
a good
were
one.
So right. Look at that.
2007 is one Nailed of the all-time it. Great years. It's true.
Yep.
And 25 reviews includes 3 games from Burger King.
Oh, yeah. I love that.
You know him.
I remember the day I went to Burger King to get them.
There is a 2-page ad for Rainbow Six Vegas, and I just included it because I just love these two games so much, Vegas and Vegas 2. I think it's a little bit sad for me that now Rainbow Six is exclusively a multiplayer-only game.
Well, what's insane to me is that Ubisoft, Rainbow Six was such a big franchise. Obviously, it started on PC. It was a big deal there. And then Rainbow Six 3 really blew up on the original Xbox and was actually one of the first huge successes on Xbox Live. It came in on a year into Xbox Live. It wasn't there at launch. But then Vegas comes along on the 360. Again, brilliant game, huge success. They do Vegas 2 in like a year. They turned around the sequel pretty fast. And then Rainbow Six disappeared for like, I don't know, what was it, 8 years until Siege in 2015. Like it's crazy that Ubisoft had this gigantic franchise with such momentum to it. And they just kept like starting up new Rainbow Six projects and like they just weren't getting traction and they kept canceling them. And it's wild to me when you look back at the history of Rainbow Six.
In between Vegas,
Ryan, would you call this a licensed game?
No, they owned it by then. They owned Clancy by then. The entire brand.
Ubisoft owns Tom Clancy.
Yeah,
No, there's still Tom Clancy books and stuff not published by Ubisoft.
Well, they at least own all the video game stuff. I know that. That's an interesting situation
because like Nickelodeon owns Turtles, so they technically don't license Turtles.
Right.
It's published Turtles. Yeah, you just made it more confusing, Ryan. Thank you. 20 questions didn't get any
They can make any Tom... Yeah, in the beginning, they were licensing it from Clancy and the Clancy estate, but yeah, they outright bought all the video game rights a long time ago.
Man.
Well, in between Vegas 2 and Siege, they announced Rainbow Six Patriot.
Right.
Right? But then that never came out. An ad for Oblivion, but what's interesting is that it's for the PS3 version.
PS3.
Coming November to PlayStation 3.
That's funny.
Spoiler, that was, I think
janky.
That version was not great.
Yeah.
Compared to the 360 version.
But also, I guess it was a launch game for PS3. I just don't remember that. Little bit of a mention of IGN in the top. It got an Editor's Choice Award.
Well, and that absolute masterpiece quote from Official Xbox Magazine would have been me because I did review that game for OXM.
Interesting. Nice. The details of what was on your disc, your demo disc, you had demos for Need for Speed, Carbon, WWE SmackDown versus Raw 2007, LEGO Star Wars 2, the original trilogy. So wait, maybe Justin would know. What was in the LEGO Star Wars 1?
LEGO Star Wars 1 is the prequels.
That's so weird that they started with the prequels. Well, I guess it was coming right off the heels of the prequels, but
they did the prequels, and then 1 year later they did this, and then what most people played was that they did the first complete saga, which was the LEGO Star Wars 1 and 2 combined into all six movies in one game.
No dialogue days.
Yeah.
No dialogue in those?
Yeah, all just pantomiming and grunting.
Really clever.
Demo of the Sonic the Hedgehog reboot. Is that what it was?
That would have been that reboot. Yep.
Yeah, Sonic 06.
And then Fusion Frenzy 2. Ryan, was it just like a whole other team working on this demo disc?
Well, our team was one guy, Dave Reese, which eventually became two guys. Dane Fredrickson joined him at one point, probably by this time. But it was, and then we had an external development team that we worked with too. Because basically every OXM demo disc had to be certified by the Xbox certification team every month, so that they had to test it and make sure it wasn't going to crash your Xbox when you put our demo disc in your console. So it was a smaller effort than you think from a manpower perspective, but it was a bigger effort than you might expect for what we actually had to do to put that disc out every month. And honestly, by this time, the OXM demo disc had peaked. Its powers had peaked, and we were kind of starting to come down off the mountain here, because then demos were starting to go on Xbox Live.
Yeah. Right.
So the disc had lost some of its inherent power. But hey, we still had lots of good stuff. I mean, that's a nice array of demos right there.
For sure.
And you had more than just demos on here. You had an OXM Game of the Year 2006 ballot that people could vote on somehow through the disc.
Mm-hmm.
You had
a video
showcase. You had videos for Halo Wars, Call of Duty 3, Blue Dragon, and more. A Saints Row blowout, which is like some sort of a preview that was on the disc. And then like a holiday Xbox quiz, a Bullet Witch art gallery. So it's just more than just demos.
Yeah, we tried to get more clever with it as time went on to offer more on there. And I'll point out too, the little text at the bottom there, in the bottom right, we call those bottom fillers. They're on every page, every editorial page. And I probably wrote a million of those over the 10 years I was at OXM.
What does it say?
This says to unlock, you can earn 800 OXM points to unlock extra disc goodies.
Yeah, we had a little scoring system. But sometimes the bottom fillers ranged from informative to supplemental to the main content on the page to just outright jokes. So that sometimes we were scraping the bottom of the barrel, just like, all right, what do we write down here? Just write something goofy. So we always had fun with them, though.
Here in the message center, there's a little blurb from Ryan down in the bottom right corner. What did they ask? This is the meet the team section. They asked you, what are your top five Gears of War multiplayer moments? So you said one, curb stomping, it just never gets old. Two, shotgunning an enemy's head clean off, then watching it roll down the stairs. Three, hitting two foes with a single round from the grenade launcher and watching both explode into jibs. 4, reviving a fallen Rob Smith, then double teaming his unsuspecting assailant. And 5, tagging a nearby enemy with a grenade and running away just before he exploded.
Oh, yeah, the grenade tags Gears 1, are such a funny
yeah,
one.
Yeah, Gears 1 was such a fun multiplayer time, man. It was that was a great, great moment in history.
Agreed.
I don't know who this band is, but they're just the most 2000s pop punk or emo band I could imagine in my mind. Plus 44, is that the band? I've never heard that.
Seems like it, yeah.
Not familiar with them, but good slice.
Oh, yeah, look, go back real quick. Look at that. MySpace.com/plus44.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's getting pretty late, even for MySpace.
Parental advisory. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But then it also says edited version also available, Sam. So
yeah.
The whole family. Plus 44 is really for the whole family. There's a letter wondering where the chess game is. Do you guys have any inside info about a chess game for the 360? I thought it would have been available already through Live Marketplace since they have Spades, Hearts, and all the retro arcade classics. Surely there's room for chess. I ask you guys because I know you can get answers. I don't remember, but I guess, Ryan, there must have been a chess game on Xbox Live Arcade at some point.
I'm sure at some point there was like a, you know, one of those sort of pseudo fancy 3D chess games with like with knights and wizards and stuff as the prop.
Battle chess?
Yeah, exactly. Stuff like that. Now, fun fact about the letter section. I ran the letter section at OXM for a long, long time. And so I odds are I wrote most, if not all, of these responses.
Oh, nice.
Did you write the letters ever, though?
Sometimes. Sometimes. In the pre-internet days, when we literally only would get physical letters, you know, and some if we had, you know, we didn't get enough good ones, sometimes it'd just be like, all right, let me just come up with something here.
Well, we always like read the first issue of a magazine. It's like as a healthy letter section. You're like, all right.
How did they have letters? On the staff credits, you can see Ryan's name there as a senior editor. And then under editorial contributors, we see one Dan Stapleton.
No way.
Yeah.
I wonder what that is. It must have been.
Well, I think we'll see that
Dan
later.
Dan was allergic to console and still is allergic to console.
He probably asked about
the
chess.
No, that's not true.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
There was a period of time when some RTS games were coming to 360, like Lord of the Rings, Battle for Middle Earth, and then Command & Conquer. And I think Dan is going to preview a Command & Conquer game later in this issue. Also, Will Smith contributed to this issue. So.
Not that Will Smith. The other one.
Yeah, you follow him on Twitter.
So this is an ad for the 2006 VGA Video Game Awards. Is this the game?
Was this like the first one? Yeah.
Samuel L. Jackson hosting.
Yeah, so, because it was all a Spike thing originally.
This is the same awards that like Jeff Keighley hosts today?
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They've gone through this U of like they were huge on Spike, and then there were some years that were maybe not so great, and now it's on an upswing again.
Well, there's a lot.
Sleep game.
There's a lot happening here. It was just a generic like punk guy with a mohawk playing an arcade machine, even though, Sam, his hands are like inside the cabinet. Like, insert himself.
He's fixing it, really.
Yeah.
And then really. The side art has a chimpanzee with a mohawk,
skeleton chimpanzee with crazy
playing
hair.
Playing a joystick.
Yeah. I mean, I would watch these.
This was the height of Photoshop in 2006.
Yeah. This is an ad for Fear, which has an IGN quote: "Say hello to the season's first fall blockbuster." IGN. Mm-hmm. Top shooter 2005 lives on.
I don't know about that.
Yeah. Good game, though.
That's what we said.
Yeah, it is. It is a good game.
Here's a piece from you, Ryan. 5 things you didn't know about Overlord.
Huh.
Oh, yeah. Overlord.
I barely remember this game.
I like this game and its sequel.
Me too. I have a soft spot for Overlord and Overlord 2. They're like, they're like Pikmin if you played an evil guy.
Yeah.
They were kind of trying to start a franchise with this thing, but then it sort of petered out. Didn't go. There was a DS game, I think.
That's
also.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Codemasters. That's right.
Codemasters,
okay.
Yeah.
This. Oh. Now was it really a DS one? Now I want to look that up.
The bottom text, the filler text is: "Did you know Fable's Peter Molyneux was the main man behind the PC's 1997 hit Be Evil Management Sim Dungeon Keeper?"
What, Damon? There was an Overlord game in 2015.
Which one was it?
It's called Overlord Fellowship of Evil, PlayStation 4 and Xbox One.
I don't remember that.
Wow.
I don't.
It got bad. It got horrible.
For you. Yeah.
Full page ad for the Burger King games. Now creepy on multiple levels. They focus on Sneak King. They were only $3.99 with the purchase of what? Some kind of a meal at Burger King.
Yeah.
And creepy on multiple levels. It works so well because you creep around on four different levels. So like it's such,
exactly.
It's clever.
Exactly.
See, I can crack the code of this ad copy. Usually we show ad copy that none of us can really parse because it's from like 1984 and the references are lost to time.
Yeah. And these were Xbox exclusives, were they not, Ryan?
That is correct. Yes. Yeah. These were absolute cult classics, even right at the time, and they have lived on as such.
They were developed by a company named Blitz that's not in business anymore, but I think they did a lot of licensed games, and they probably, mm-hmm. I'm sure that they made these games on the cheap, considering the console was only 1 year old at this point, and they already had these.
You know
crazy-
what's forgotten is that these were for sale at Burger King, and they're cheap, and it was fun to have these on your shelf or whatever. But there was the other things that made a splash were the downloadable free games that were based on stuff. Like one was a PT Cruiser Racer.
You're thinking of Yaris, the Toyota Yaris.
Yaris game. Racer, is that what it was? And then was there a chip-based racer as well?
Oh, yeah.
There was a Doritos thing or something,
right? There was a Doritos one.
Like Doritos tubes or something?
Some Doritos tubes, please.
Yeah, it was three 3D Doritos. Three Doritos.
Oh, the puppy ones.
Yeah.
There's a preview of Rogue Warrior. If anyone remembers this game.
Oh, yeah. I remember the guide for that one. I didn't do it, but I remember working.
It's kind of infamous for just being terrible, but also having its fans and like being kind of a cult classic.
Yeah, we had two big fans on staff that I will not name, but Rogue Warrior 2 especially, I think.
Is that one? And so did the original Rogue Warrior not have, it had some voice talent, some notable voice talent. His name escapes me. He was in Sin City.
It looks. It looks so funny.
Yeah, I can't remember.
Well, and the if you look over there on the left rail, the publisher information. This was back. This was right when Bethesda was first starting to publish games, in addition to developing them. Bethesda published this.
That's right. Yeah.
What was the game with like the lady assassin that they published, like Scarlet?
Oh
or something?
Yeah.
Is that what it was called?
There was a game called Wet.
Wet.
That was it.
Or was that THQ? I don't remember.
No, I think you nailed it. I think that's it.
Yep.
This preview ends up with first or third person perspectives, authentic weapons and gear, and all the colorful language that sailors use in real life. Rogue Warrior could be one of 2007's big contenders. I don't know. IGN gave it a 1.5.
I think OXM hit it pretty hard, too, whenever we did review it.
A 1.5?
It's a 1.5 from IGN.
Well, that's worse than God Hand, which we gave a low score to, but a bunch of staff members liked.
This is a two-page ad for that Sonic the Hedgehog game. And my only question is, on the right side here, who's this human woman?
that's the girl he kisses.
Does he kiss a human girl? I don't even know.
He does in one game. If it's not this one, then it's another one.
I don't
Sonic's
like that.
Sonic's girlfriend's just a lady in one of these games. It's really funny.
Okay, and also, above the ESRB rating for everyone, it says, actual screenshot. What here is an actual screenshot?
It's an amalgamation of a few screenshots.
This,
sure.
This just proves you can just say that whenever you want.
It says it in the top.
It says it more than once. Yeah, it says it in the top too.
About Mansion, actual screenshot. But
apparently, Robotnik and the human girl are not an actual screenshot.
If any of our Sonic the Hedgehog super fans in Scoop Nation can let us know who this human woman is in this game.
We scared them all off years ago.
Yeah, that's true. Yep. With a byline from Dan Stapleton, this Command & Conquer 3 Tiberium Wars preview is from him. I guess it's an interview with EA or a developer on the game.
Yeah.
I probably played this. I think I played all those RTS games on 360.
There were some good ones. I mean, I played all the way through Battle for Middle Earth 2, Lord of the Rings, on the 360, and it actually played well.
Let's see. Eternal Sonata preview. And then Battlefield Bad Company. This comes from you, Ryan.
From me. Look at that.
Mm-hmm. It says it's a first look at Bad Company. Which one do people like better, Bad Company or Bad Company 2?
You, right?
Second one, I think.
Yeah.
Well, okay, stop the presses. Her name is Princess Elise, and he does kiss her in that game.
There you go.
I didn't need to know that. That's cursed knowledge.
She's Princess Elise, Keeper of the Chaos Emerald, or a Chaos Emerald, or something like that.
Does he kiss her to get the emerald?
Yeah, I think so. No, I think he has to protect the emerald alongside her. But yeah, I'm sure you can look up a video of the romance scene if you'd like.
No.
They go on a date and stuff. It was a thing.
I'm good.
This is a two-page ad for Final Fantasy XI Online coming to Xbox 360. And I just want to note, these servers are still running today. Maybe not on 360, but at least the PC ones.
We had the beta of this on disc with the magazine at one point. And we would get emails from people way after the fact, like months and months later, saying, can I get another disc from you? I lost mine. The reason is because you couldn't uninstall that Final Fantasy XI beta without the disc. Like, you needed to put the beta disc in to remove the beta.
Oh, no.
And we did not have a very large, like, back room stash of extra discs.
Wow.
And here's their huge review of Gears of War. It's quite
the spread. Dan reviewed this. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, I like, Ryan, I like you attributed the design of the review to the actual designer.
Art director, yeah. Julianne Brown, who's extremely talented.
Well, needless to say, you liked Gears of War very much. Real quick, as an aside, sandwiched in this review is an ad for Xbox Live Prime Time. Ryan, do you remember what that was?
Nope.
Xbox.com/primetime. It says a world of options, and then it's just accessories for the 360. But yeah. I don't know what it's about.
It looks like I thought it would be TV related, but it's not. There's like a driving wheel.
Well,
and
that headset, the wireless headset, was really good. The HD DVD player, of course, didn't well last that long because HD DVD didn't last.
Is it
that
pictured
long.
Here? Is it the thing in the lower
the bottom, the sort of 7 o'clock positions down there?
Yeah. Yeah, to the left of the Xbox Live card.
Yeah.
The media remote, vision camera, all that stuff.
That remote was cool.
Oh, yeah.
One quote in the Gears of War review. Much of Gears of War looks like it was shot on location in Iraq.
I don't know about that.
It was kind of the start of the every video game is brown phase.
Yeah, and saturated and
And also sort of deliberate maybe with its camera and you know how it pulled in on you when you roadie ran and yada yada. So
this is a really long review. You gave it a 10. Give it a 10 out of 10.
Yeah, I would still give it a 10. I think that review holds up. From
I agree.
One question.
Gears 1. Oh, good, good. I played a lot. I don't know. I played a whole lot of Gears 1. Same as you, Ryan. Like me and my coworkers at the website I worked for. That was just that was like the peak of me playing video games online. Was like Halo 2 and 3 and Gears 1 just every night.
Yeah, 04 to 07 or so. That window.
Yep.
Same here.
In the verdict, he said, believe the hype, 2006's killer app delivers on its promises. Its well-balanced multiplayer will drive live for months. One negative was piecing together shreds of plot yields only tattered answers. And then a lingering question was, why do smart enemies announce that they're reloading?
reloading.
Good question. And it's your holiday gift guide, 2006 holiday gift guide, stuff every Xbox gamer needs. You need your keyboard, your wireless headset.
The prime time stuff.
Your 5.1 surround sound speakers. Stuff every Xbox.
I rock that Halo 2 headset on the previous page for years. That Plantronics Halo 2 headset.
Nice.
It's a really good sound quality.
I guess this is before the keyboard attachment for the controller was released.
Right? Oh, yeah.
That'd come a little bit later. That was really cool. I thought that was actually really useful especially for inputting codes for in the marketplace. Stuff every Xbox gamer wants, your vision camera, a Nyko, a multi HDMI, adapter, GameFly subscription. This particular
I had
TV.
That Westinghouse HDTV on my desk at OXM for a while.
Dude, it's 37 inches and $1,500.
Yeah. Oh, times have changed.
It says the copy says this set is the one that home theater nerd and OXM senior editor Ryan McCaffrey uses on his desk.
Oh, see,
office.
I even wrote. Look at that.
You were assigned the blurb for that one. I see.
Clearly, yeah.
Listeners, whenever we do awards or a top 100 list, we have to assign blurbs to people.
Something I'm doing that right now.
Something has
I wrote
to be
Damon's
done.
Name next to some just yesterday.
Yep.
On Monday.
Writing some blurbs for
and Ryan's. Justin got
Game of the Year award nominees. Stuff every Xbox gamer wants. The
Zune.
The Zune, yeah.
The HD DVD player, both on one page. Oh, yep. Man.
Mm-hmm. And then I like how one of the entries is just every game in Xbox Live Arcade. Every game. You calculated that as a value of $240 at this time.
Where's the Zune? Oh, the lower right?
Bottom right, yeah.
Yeah. The Zune, baby.
Yeah. Custom faceplate. Oh, yeah. Stuff every Xbox gamer doesn't know they want. This Mitsubishi Diamond Series HDTV. It's 73 inches, $6,500.
Wow.
That would have been
a... Is it a rear real... projector? What is it? I can't even tell what it is.
They're calling it an HDTV.
It's just an LCD.
I'm sure it's just...
Yeah.
Yeah, well, LCD.
It would have been so big. It would have been enormous.
That is big for the time, and it must have been thick. I remember our early, really large TVs at IGN were really heavy and really thick.
In the bottom right corner, does this Linksys router bring back memories for anyone? Because I think that's the exact same router.
Oh, yeah, I had that.
I had one of those. Yeah.
Yep. Wow.
Boy.
That would take you back. How about a crystal icing iced out faceplate for your 360?
Cool.
$300.
What? You would think faceplates would have not gone away because they're just like easy money. It's just like, why not do a faceplate on your system? Like,
they went away. They went away for the 360 when they redesigned it.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Also, I guess there was a 15th anniversary Reservoir Dogs DVD out that year. That movie is really old now.
All right, here come the reviews now.
That would have already looked grainy on that 72-inch television.
Yeah, it's true. Sam and Justin, on their review scale, they have an 11. They went off the charts.
No, read the description.
I know. It says unicorn will never happen, never. But it's, you know, it's you
and have it didn't. Listed.
At Game Scoop, we say an 11 out of 10 is off the charts with a Z.
Yeah.
Rainbow Six Vegas was done by...
Who did I review about? This?
This is really me? Long. No, this no, is Paul.
Okay, I think I might have done the second one.
Mm. 8.5 for Rainbow Six Vegas, yeah.
Solid score.
And then in the middle of... So I, you know, when I prep these magazines, I like edit out pages that we don't need to, you know... they're edited for time. Yeah. In the middle of this review section is this... clearly branded segment.
Oh, yeah, advertorial.
Yeah, the advertorial about... cell phone games, you know, I guess it's singular, the cell phone company at the time. It's probably the one who's paying for this. But this is so long, and I edited so much out of it. I couldn't, it's like 30 pages long in the middle of the review section. It's called The New Way to Play. Our expectation of what a cell phone can do is change drafting, blah, blah, blah. They're trying to get people to play and download.
That paid the bills, man.
I mean, sure, I get that. It's just, it's such a long feature. I love this photo. Look at this guy in the foreground, like,
yeah.
He's having a great
cool
time.
Cool 2000s house, too. They have disco ball.
I don't think that's a disco ball. But
so what is it then?
On the wall.
They have all these stats.
By the way, I'll just point out for anybody that was wondering that may have the wrong idea in their head. We, the OXM editorial team, had nothing to do with this. Like, we didn't create it. Like, we just get told, oh, there's going to be an advertorial insert in this spot, but we don't know what it is. We don't produce it. We didn't write it. So just in case you're wondering, like, that was, that's totally like a separate deal.
But was there an internal team, like at Future?
Sometimes.
That
yeah.
would make this? Okay.
Sometimes these would get created totally externally, but yeah, there was also an internal team that would do this.
I like that rug. Sorry.
There's at least stats. 25% of cell phone owners play games on their handset at least once a month.
Oh,
yeah,
no.
Yeah. The average video game age of a gamer is 33, blah, 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 blah. You may never talk again once you play games like Texas Hold'em, Call of Duty 2, Top Gun, Gulf Crisis, and True Crime, Streets of L.A.
On what your is that Call of Duty like?
Yeah, I would love to see that Call of Duty.
I played all those games. This is the era when I first started doing mobile game stuff. 2006, actually. That's the exact year.
So was it Call of Duty?
Yep.
Was it like side-scrolling?
It was like top-down.
Okay.
Commando.
An Akari Warriors.
Yeah, like Commando. Yeah, it was an Akari Warriors. Like,
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, remember all of these.
It's funny.
And we used to, the way that we had to review them, by the way, is they would mail me a phone loaded up with like their six or seven latest games, and I would play them and review them and then have to return the phone.
It's easy to laugh at this stuff, but like as we've talked before, these games are probably just gone now, right?
They're gone.
Oh, sure.
And, including gone. John Romero worked on a bunch of them.
Yeah.
Just wait for Digital Eclipse to collect them all.
Paris Hilton had her puzzle game, Paris Hilton's Diamond Quest. There was a Lumines mobile game, apparently. Whoa. Yeah.
Ooh, I did not remember that.
And then, Ryan, there's Splinter Cell Double Agent.
The ultimate port of Splinter Cell Double Agent.
Yeah. Like I said, I cut a lot of this out, but it just keeps going on and on. Say goodbye to boredom, no matter where you are. Entertainment is as close as your wireless phone. Oh, yeah, you can play. Top 10 places to play. The commute. Hanging with friends, waiting rooms, car trips, lines, school, lines. Doing laundry, at the gym, the airport, and my favorite is number 10, anytime.
Anytime.
We don't need you to explain this to us.
It keeps going.
Wait. I didn't know I could stir pasta and game.
Yeah. It keeps going. What is a gamer? Blah, blah, blah. Games are for everyone. Can't decide what to try. Here's all the different genres of games. 32% of heads of households report that they play games on wireless devices.
Here's what's insane about this is like, it's like, it seems very well done, right? Like it's informative and it's not trying to be it's okay. Like on the scale of advertorials, like it's got all these stats in it and like, it seems really well composed, but they stuck it like right in the middle of an Xbox magazine that like nobody that read that magazine is like, yes.
Do you think it would have been a spread across all of the future mags? Like in
probably.
Sometimes it just
like
depends
an insert
on
flyer kind of.
Yeah, but I will say, in our defense, this something like that goes on this long would have been exceedingly rare. Like, this did not happen very often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyway, that concludes that, and we're back to the reviews. Bevo 7 got a 7.5. Reservoir Dogs, the game, got a 4. This is a time when every...
I actually don't remember that existed.
Every tangentially related gangster property was getting an open world GTA-like game. Godfather, Scarface.
Yeah, I remember Scarface.
I reviewed Scarface, The World Is Yours, and the producer on that game literally still hates me to this day for 4.5 I gave that game.
Oh, no. You reviewed the Burger King games. Big Bumpkin got a 5. Sneak King got a 6. And Pocket Bike Racer got a 6.5. Apparently, that's the
not
best
bad.
One.
Yeah, not bad.
Yeah, there you go. Ryan, you reviewed Doom. On Xbox Live Arcade.
They ported the original, of course, to Xbox Live Arcade.
Yeah. You gave it an 8.
It's still great. It's still great today.
Oh, yeah. Doom and Doom 2 are still super fun to play today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Dig Dug got a 7.5.
Mm-hmm. Where did you Dig Dug?
Corey Cohen?
That's our managing editor. Yeah.
Nice.
2007, the best gaming year ever. You're going to get Shadowrun, Lost Planet, Crackdown 2 Human, Bioshock, Halo 3, Forza Motorsport 2, Mass Effect, Lost Odyssey, Blue Dragon. Whew. It was a really good year.
What a lineup, man. Even those like games that didn't pan out in the end were just so exciting to cover and play at the time, like Lost Odyssey and Blue Dragon.
Yeah, they were all new and fun. Yeah.
Oh my gosh,
it just felt good.
This is your little aside, your filler at the bottom of the page. Some superb-looking non-exclusive games for next year include Grand Theft Auto 4. The Darkness.
That one didn't happen. Yeah, that got delayed.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was an 08 game. Yeah, that's right.
Where was Too Human at this time?
Probably busy getting delayed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one would.
It took a while to come out.
Yeah.
Well, they made it.
Well, that was a demo I played on probably download. I think it was a significant download demo.
They made a Too Human 2, right?
No, they never got. They never made it past. They planned a trilogy and didn't get past the first game.
I mean, there's potentially an Eternal Darkness in development right now, also, right?
Is that true?
Yeah, there was like a crowdsourced Eternal Darkness that we were covering.
Well, spiritual 4 years successor. Ago? Yeah, nothing to do with Nintendo and.
The rumor mill or inbox, whatever you want to call this here.
This section. This was this like cool. This was like kind of a. More like a Maxim type, like, hey, let's have funny little one-off stories that we can make little jokes about.
Yeah. Well, there was a leak, a file containing art from a number of upcoming Ubisoft titles, many of which had not yet been announced. Among the revelations were the name and location of Splinter Cell 5, Conviction, in Washington, D.C., And then there was a new Prince of Persia. That'd be the 2008 one with the sort of cel-shaded style. Another entry in the Far Cry series, Far Cry 3, I think.
I guess.
No.
No?
To that Far Cry
2?
Mm-hmm. 3 wasn't until after 2010.
Okay. Something called Surf's Up Shaun White Snowboarding and a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles game based on the upcoming CGI animated movie. And then I guess a year, the defective Xbox 360s were a story already just 1 year into the lifespan.
It didn't take long.
Yeah. Yeah, you have a whole blurb about how they're going to be free repairs for all consoles manufactured in 2005. And then later on, they would expand that, I think.
And IGN would start a very rude podcast called Three Red Lights.
That's really true. That's true.
Hey, wait, go back and read the blurb. If you read the blurb at the second half where it says, think Sony, starting
think
there.
Think Sony will do the same on their HDTV price system, or that Nintendo will foot the medical bills whenever little Billy pokes his kid sister's eye out with a Wiimote. You don't think so.
That's great.
Yeah. He said Xbox is considering an import section of Xbox Live Arcade. In an interview with gaming website Gamasutra, XBLA group manager Greg Canessa expressed enthusiasm at the possibility of offering Japanese and other foreign offerings for gamers to enjoy. Don't think that ever happened, but it's a neat idea.
What's the Weird Al thing?
No, I actually don't know. Something about Zune. Oh, yeah. It's something about Zune. You can use Xbox Live points to buy songs in your Zune MP3 player.
Okay.
Something like that. And then there,
great
the
movie,
final,
by the way, if you get a chance to watch the Weird Al movie, it's really fun.
How did you watch it? It's only on the Roku channel.
Yeah, I don't get that.
Yeah, no, our friend brought over their Roku login and just downloaded the app and watched it.
I do want to watch it. The final thing is an editorial from Jeff Keighley. The Japan problem. Just about.
Yeah, he was our back page columnist for a while.
Interesting. And then the final little blurb at the bottom, the filler text was, with Wii pre-orders selling out in minutes and huge launch day anticipation building, will Nintendo suddenly be Microsoft's biggest rival? We'll see. See, indeed. And that's the holiday issue of the holiday 2006 issue of Official Xbox Magazine.
Yeah, we did 13 issues a year. The 13th one was just called the holiday issue. It was a totally regular issue of the magazine.
Just not numbered.
At some point, they figured out, the bean counters figured out, hey, if you just divide 52 by 4, it's 13, you know, if you take 4 weeks to do a magazine. So we can get an extra issue in every year. So, we did 13 issues a year rather than 12.
And that brings us to Video Game 20 Questions. Our suggestion this week comes from simply John. In an unknown, undisclosed location. Let the questioning begin.
Could this game have appeared in the 2006 holiday? Was a holiday issue or whatever? The issue of OXM we just flipped through.
It actually could have.
Uh-oh, okay.
Could be Dig Dug.
Could be Dig Dug.
Was this game exclusive to a console platform?
It was.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so we can rule out Nintendo right away based on the first answer.
Yeah, but the way I phrased it, it's like, you know, I don't know. Like, you took a shot at the Wii. Yeah, exactly. So we should spend a question to clarify. Okay, was this game exclusive to an Xbox console?
It was at one time.
Well, okay. That's around 07... Or 06.
Did this start its life as an Xbox 360 game?
No.
Okay.
Did it start its life? Well, wait. I mean, I get. Like, did it start its life as an original Xbox game?
No.
That's what?
What?
Wait a second. So, it. At one time was exclusive to an Xbox console, but not the Xbox or the 360. It could have appeared.
The question was, did it start its life on Xbox 360?
Oh, so maybe it was one of the rare games that got ported over.
I don't know.
You know, Duke Nukem Forever came to mind, but that wasn't exclusive.
How does something become an Xbox exclusive if it wasn't on Xbox originally?
Well, I'm thinking about who they acquired, like, over the years. Like, they, you know, they didn't always own Bungie. Or, you know, other studios. Rare.
I'm still a little confused here.
Yeah, so am I.
Do you play as a human?
No.
Okay, I think it's a Conquer game.
Yeah. It could be Conquer's little Conquer Live and Reloaded or whatever it was.
That's definitely a good, you're definitely, guys are on the right track with that.
Was this game
part of a series?
Yes.
Was this game developed in Europe?
Yes.
Just go for it. Was this Conquer Live and Reloaded?
Hold on. You might not know the rules. One of the rules of the game is once we guess the name of the game, if we're wrong, we lose. No. So we have to keep, but like, I think you're probably right. Like, but we should ask some clarifying questions.
What was this game, first of all?
What?
Is that the name of the game?
Live and Reloaded?
Yeah.
And it was a remake. It was a full rotten remake of Bad Fur Day with multiplayer.
That's the name of it. Live and Reloaded?
Mm-hmm.
I think so, right?
Damon, did this game feature fur shading?
I don't think so.
No. Oh, no. Okay. Well,
it could be Perfect Dark for the launch.
Yeah, I was thinking about that too. Was this game made by Rare?
Yes, that's 10.
The other one, or it's grabbed by the ghoulies.
Didn't we ask if you could play as a human?
Oh yeah, you did. And so grabbed by the ghoulies, you did play as a human.
I mean, so I don't know, like this Banjo-Kazooie.
What is it called? Nuts and Bolts?
Nuts and Bolts.
Although that was always an Xbox exclusive, right? So I don't know. Does this game star a bear and bird?
Yes.
Hey! Does this game heavily focus on like vehicle building?
No.
Okay. So wait.
Banjo-Kazooie did end up on the Xbox 360 as an exclusive eventually.
Yeah, I went back and 100% of that game not that many years ago.
Did this game come out originally on a cartridge?
Yes.
All right. So it's just Banjo-Kazooie.
Or Banjo-Tooie.
Yes,
is this the first of its name in a series?
No.
All right. Did it come out after the year 2000?
Yes, that's 15.
All right.
Banjo-Tooie, good sir?
Yes, it is. Banjo-Tooie. Nicely done.
It's usually hard for us to get at those if we don't go from the Xbox backwards, because if we go from the 64, we get thrown off by the year because it came out after 2000, right?
Yeah. 2000 on Nintendo 64, and then the HD version 2009 on 360. I went back and played both those games.
They had such a high frame rate on the 360 that I felt a little woozy sometimes in them.
Mm. I keep trying to convince Tim Schafer to make a new Banjo game, but he doesn't want to because he's
so funny, Ryan.
He's making original things, which I can't blame him for. But he would be the perfect he and his team at Double Fine would be the perfect people to do this.
Yeah, that would be good. Banjo-Tooie, I think it's not as good. It's not the classic that Kazooie is.
Sure. I love both of them. This one has some pretty cool heights in it. Not as many great levels, but like I really like the Fire and Ice Mountain. It's really cool.
This is a cool time.
Multiplayer.
It was a cool time when these HD versions of these Nintendo 64 games were coming to Xbox Live. Like Perfect Dark that's such a great version of that game.
Yeah.
Yep. That's what I was going to say. Even though I don't love Tooie that much, it benefited so much from that port just because it ran at like 12 frames per second on the N64.
This had a 4-player split screen first person shooter mode.
Yeah, it's crazy. It was in that era of like cramming every single thing in that you can.
Yeah, this is one level I didn't like, the carnival level. It was just kind of like bland and a lot of backtracking. But a lot of it was so good.
I also love the commitment to just lore and continuity in Banjo-Tooie. Where like Mario games don't give a shit if like you played the last Mario game, whereas like Banjo-Tooie directly follows Kazooie and like all the characters are like you need like it's like a direct story sequel, which is just weird and unusual.
I really crave this style of game. Like I just Like there's certain itches that even like God of War scratches with like the arena exploration areas, which, you know, do it for me. But like, you know, there's just so many secrets and interesting intricacies to these levels. And I really miss that in games in general. I mean, that's kind of what open world games are now, but it really worked compartmentalized in this one. Mm.
Yeah. And we don't get these very often. Like Mario Odyssey is the last game of this type that we've done, right?
Yeah, exactly. Good example.
Which Ryan reviewed.
Unfortunately, Ukulele, I thought was just, it just didn't end up being like fun for some reason. Like it had a lot of great elements to it.
It didn't have, I don't know if it was a budget thing, like they didn't have or what it was, but it just didn't get there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was missing something. Anyway, nicely job. Well done, everyone. Thank you for the suggestion. John, viewers, listeners, if you have your own suggestions for Video Game 20 questions, email them to me at the email address, gamescoop@IGN.com. And that is all the scoops that we have for you this week. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Justin. Thank you to Ryan for joining us today. Everybody, check out Podcast Unlocked if you have not before. Another excellent podcast hosted by Ryan. Thank you to Tayo working behind the scenes to make this episode possible. My name is Damon. This is IGN Game Scoop, and we're out.